Alvin Ng is a native New York playwright, director, performer, and educator. He's currently an assistant professor in the Department of Theater at Goucher College in Baltimore. Ng was a resident Hong Kong City University Fulbright specialist in U.S. Studies and Theater in 2011. At City U, in collaboration with his wife, actress-director Wendy Washto, he conceived and directed, oh, there she is, Our Town, China, USA, devised a theater oral history project. That year, Alvin also made his Asian debut. The U.S. consulate in Guangzhou invited him to perform his memoir monologue play, The Last Emperor of Flushing. In March 2013, the Pan-Asian Repertory Theater will present the world premiere of his play, Three Trees. In Paris, the city where it's set, the play was presented as a stage reading by the Moving Parts Theater and at the Sorbonne University's International Conference. Three Trees is the first work of Ng's portrait play, cycle about artists and portraiture. And the play was chosen as one of three plays to present it at the Comparative Drama Conference in Baltimore, Maryland. Let's welcome Alvin Ng. And with him on this collaborative talk tonight is Laurie Wilson, who earned her undergraduate degree in art history from Wellesley College, her master's in fine arts and fine arts education from Columbia University, and her PhD in art history from the City University of New York. She received psychoanalytic training at the NYU Psychoanalytic Institute, where she is on the faculty as a clinical associate professor of psychiatry. She directed the graduate art therapy program at NYU for 23 years and is professor emerita there. She's published extensively in three fields: art therapy, art history, psychoanalysis, and art therapy. Her book, Alberto Giacometti, Myth, Magic, and the Man, was published by Yale University Press in 2003. She is currently completing a biography of Louise Nevelson. I think there's one book left because I bought this one. But the paperback is available.
Yes.
Right. So let's welcome our guests, Alvin Ng and
Wilson. Okay, well, it's wonderful to be here. I'm so glad everyone could join us. Thank you so much. Tonight's talk is called Three Trees, Alberto Giacometti's Art as a Theater and History. It'll be in three parts, three trees in three parts. The first part, I'll be talking about the play, and then we're so honored to have Laurie Wilson with us here, and she'll be talking in the second part. And then in the final part, we'd like to open it up for questions, and Laurie will be happy to sign her book, too. So it's an amazing book, Alberto Giacometti, Myth, Magic, and the Man. So just wanted to wear that. Okay, as you know, Three Trees is a historical drama. It's about the unique relationship between Alberto Giacometti and his muse model, the Japanese existential philosopher Isako Yanahara. And for my interpretation of their relationship, one of the cornerstones is just that all the technology in the world can never ever replace the synergy that happens between people in a room, or even two people in a room. But having said that, we want to welcome everyone who's watching this on the internet tonight, and joining us on the web in the future. But in that way, though, too, this synergy it happens with any people in a room, but it's very strong between an artist and the model. It's a very intimate. Process, how that happens, and for some people, this synergy is the essence of art, of theater, and even of love. And for many great artists and thinkers, this synergy is maybe the highest plane of that love. The very consummation of that primal need comes out when they're creating art. So in some ways, for many creative artists and thinkers, like just the act of creating art is really the highest consummation of love. And in many ways, that's what this story is. In some ways, it's a very unusual love story, too. Not that there are many usual love stories, but this is a very unusual one, too. During the 50s, Giacometti created many portraits of Isako Yanahara in drawing, in painting, and in sculpture. And for a number of consecutive summers, he kept flying him back from Tokyo to Paris. And at that time, international travel was not as common as it is now, And as my wife Wendy often says, he became the most expensive model in the world that way too, by flying him back and forth all that way. But they first met when Isaku was in residence at the Sorbonne. He was studying existential philosophy. He's perhaps most known at that point, he had translated Camus' The Stranger into Japanese. So he's very well known for that. And he just said walking the streets, he didn't know anyone there. His French was not that great yet. And he just saw some of Alberto's work. And he said it just moved him like nothing he'd ever seen before or since. And he just insisted on trying to meet him and eventually set up an interview with Alberto. And then it became this classic story, which I'm trying to dramatize. And then he just, when he sat for him, it was very different. Because before Isaku, Alberto was known for just wearing out his models, both physically and psychologically. On the physical level, he would just go for hours. They'd be begging him for a break. Please, can we stop? And then psychologically, Alberto was very advanced, and he would wear down his artist that way too, in both ways too. But then when he met Isaku, Isaku had a meditation background, so in that way he can meet Alberto physically, and then psychologically with his philosopher's background, he could really meet Alberto on that way too. My interpretation is that because Alberto could not dominate him in that room, he had trouble capturing his essence. He could not capture the philosopher's essence in either clay or in paint or in pencil drawings. And this led to an obsession. Like, he really had to keep working on him. He flew him back just to keep really trying to capture the philosopher's essence. And to me, through this process, a very complicated love through their art making grew. And like a lot of loves, this became a force, became an obsession. And this obsession really upended everything in its path, because prior to Isaku arriving in Paris, they had a very intimate, very insular triumvirate life of Alberto Giacometti, his wife Annette, and his brother and aide-de-camp, Diego. And Diego did so much for Alberto's work that one time, even going back, they're from Stampa, Switzerland, on one trip back, their mother said to Alberto, "Diego does so much work on your pieces. Did you ever consider crediting them to the brothers Giacometti?" Alberto was not in favor of that suggestion, as you can imagine. But that just shows how much Diego meant to his work and what a tight insular triumvirate they were. And then when Isaku arrived, they were never the same after that. And forever changed their relationship, and that's what's dramatized in this play. Just looking at how this love that started through the creation of art just grew into every aspect of their life. And for me personally, here in New York and America, we're very lucky to see many of Alberto's sculptures all the time. They're in most permanent collections in every major museum in America. But back in 2008, we were in Paris. I'm happy. Sometimes I always say that. Anyway, Three Trees was conceived on our honeymoon. On our honeymoon in 2008, we went to Paris, and we were very lucky. There was a great retrospective on him that was at the Centre Pompidou. And one of the things that they featured was apparently Giacometti always used the walls as like sketch pads. And I'm sure you know much more. Something's never changed. I think shortly after he passed away in 66, somehow his wife, his widow, was being evicted from the studio, and somehow she took the walls with her. So there at Pompidou, I don't know how they could do that. If not just if walls could speak, if walls could move, you know. So these walls moved, and at the Pompidou, they recreated his atelier right there. So it was very powerful. There you are, a few blocks from his actual atelier, and they recreated this, and they had an extensive history of a lot of the work, and they had so many of his paintings and drawings, many more than I had seen in America, and to me, they cast just as strong, if not a stronger spell than a lot of his sculpture work, and so I became enraptured by these portraits, these amazing works, and particularly his portraits of Isaku, Yanahara. And then when I learned about the backstory, I just said, oh, this could really be a play, because as Russell mentioned, this is the first of my series of portrait plays, and for years I've been really contemplating, when you when we When we become enraptured by a portrait, like, I don't know if there's no easy answer, but are we more enraptured by the model or by the artist? Like, it's hard to make that definition. Like, whose soul is reverberating more in our own souls as we look at these works? And seeing this relationship really said, this is a vehicle to really explore this further. So I started to really explore this too, and then just thinking about how this came about. And in many ways, with all the timeless works and why we're here tonight, though, too, a huge turning point in this research was I was reading everything I could on Giacometti, and then coming across Laurie's great book, and then I said, "Wow, Laurie lives about 20 blocks away," you know, and as part of her research, she had some of his Isaki Yanahara's journals, and actually he'd published many of his journals and even a few books about his sittings for Giacometti. And they were in French and Japanese, two languages I don't speak, two of many languages I don't speak or understand. And I contacted Laurie and said, would you consider letting me see some of them? And she was gracious enough to do that. And it's been a famous friendship since. So that was a big turning point in that relationship too. And so in looking at that a little deeper though too, in many ways, there were like three quotes that really talk about how theater has this timeless quality that Alberto's work has. And so looking at Giacometti's work and his life, he in some ways he was made to be dramatized. Because some people say that behind every brushstroke, behind every musical note, every danced step, every spoken word, there's a small seed of eternity in every brushstroke and every move. And when these works of art are finally totally constructed and ready to crack open the moment of their present, a powerful bridge is made between the listener, the observer, the reader, and the work of art in that present moment and with eternity. And in many ways, Alberto's work has always done that. The Giacometti, they're a natural bridge between the inanimate and the animate, the living and the dead, and all these things happen there too. And why I call these portrait plays, it comes back to, in many ways, there were sort of three quotes that can talk about the making of Three Trees too. Of course, Thornton Wilder, the Pulitzer Prize winning playwright of Our Town and many other works, he once said that, I love that he elevates himself above Molière. And Molière said that for theater, all he needed was a platform and a passion or two. The climax of my play, meaning Our Town, only needs 5 square feet and the passion to know what life means to us. So I've always carried that. And then a contemporary director, Will Pomerantz, once said that, "I often think of the theater event as a sort of seance, a place where the mysteries of time, space, and humanity are plumbed to conjure living ghosts that exist beautifully for a few minutes." And in many ways, these two experiences come together. And then Alberto Giacometti once said, "The only difference between the living and the dead is the eternal gaze." So I sort of tried to really put these things together to really capture the power of the work and the power of that relationship. And again, I call these portrait plays. It's a cycle of historical dramas about artists and portraiture, because I think in all narrative works of art, whether it's in any form, it's a form of portraiture. I feel like no matter whether it's a work that's linear or nonlinear, or representational or abstract, or harmonic or atonal, it's all about all the artists that aspiring to create portraits that stir something in our souls about the human condition. And portraits last forever, but the theater is the most ephemeral of art forms. That's why for me, just to really connect with that portrait is very strong, because those of us who work in the theater, we often say, like, when the play is over, what does theater become? I think theater becomes soul, because as great as any printed or documented, now posted record of any event is, the true essence really only exists, comes back to that synergy that happens between people. And I feel like theater is a real living testament to that belief, because even though there's always printed documents and broadcast documents, the true synergy of that soul exchange happens in your own soul, and you carry that on with you. So that's why that's why these plays are called portrait plays, because it connects down to that belief. So I just want to talk about that. And in many ways, that's what we come back to, and we try to aspire to that too in Three Trees. And can the spiritual ownership of a portrait ever be assessed? So that's some of the things we're doing. And so now we're very lucky. I want to thank you for this part too, but I'm very happy to introduce great art historian, Laurie Wilson. So Laurie, let's welcome Laurie now. Thank you.
Thank you, Alvin. I was very fortunate to be at the first reading
yes.
of Alvin's play, which keeps evolving, and I was extremely moved by how deeply he caught the nature of all the people who I'd been writing about and thinking about for 15 years. So I thought, this is extraordinary, and I think the play really is extraordinary. What I'm going to do tonight are show you a few images that at least for me, as both an art historian and formerly an artist and a psychoanalyst, gave me some insight into Alberto. So the one on the left is the famous family portrait, and Alberto is the long curly-haired kid on the far left, and he's gazing at his mother. And the mythic story was that he and his mother were intensely close, and that was the relationship most important in the family. On the right, you see the four children. Diego, the one who worked with Alberto all that time, please note that he has very flat hair. And then Otilia and Bruno, who was still alive, and I went to interview him in the late 80s. And that was how I got started on this project. And Alberto standing there. Another mythic piece that puzzled me about the family was that it was a perfectly happy childhood. And by that time I knew, I had seen in these photographs, there are none of the children smiling. None. Zero. And there are all kinds of stories of Diego putting his hand in a thresher when he was a very little kid because he didn't like the shape of his fingers. I mean, things that you would simply not imagine perfectly happy children in perfectly happy childhoods do. So I began to do some research. Alvin wanted me to say how I got into this. I had loved Giacometti's work as a young sculptor and then art historian. And a biography was written by James Lord, actually a very good biography, but biased, of course. James Lord and Giacometti were friends. Lord was a super good researcher, but he had his own views. And when I read it, I thought, well, there's some things that I have some questions about, because he presented some psychological ideas, and he was not trained in that area, and some of the psychological ideas seemed wacky to me. I was teaching in northern Italy, and it was not so far from Zurich, and I thought, okay, I'll just go to Zurich and interview the brother and interview another art historian, and that will get me started on how to write this review, or help me understand more of what was going on in the Giacometti story. So I went to Switzerland and interviewed the brother and had a very long... The brother is the one who looks like the crybaby down there, the shorter one. In any case, as a result of those few interviews and the images that I learned about, it opened more questions, things that were simply not answered in the biography or in any other writing on Giacometti. This is just to show you where they lived in the it's hard to do this. The one on the top image on the left is both a combination of a studio and an apartment that the father Giacometti worked in and that the whole family lived in. And you can see in the image on the right that it's in a deep alpine valley, just on the edge of Switzerland. Just to give you the context of where this happened. So on the left is a drawing that the father, Giovanni Giacometti, was a reasonably well-known artist in Switzerland. He made this drawing of himself, and he's holding the children and his wife, Annette. And on his right is Alberto, the curly-headed one, and he's also holding Diego. What you see is that Annette is not holding anybody or not touching anybody, but the father is doing all of the touching, all of the holding and all of the nurturing. And as I continued to do the research, I found out he was the one who was the maternal figure. And the mother was the tough one. When it was time to sell Giovanni's painting, she would if they got some money, she would take it, bite it, check it, go to the bank, find out if it was real. She was dura, which is in Italian means tough. That's what how everybody described her. The father was a fabulous painter, a colorist, and what you see on the right is one of many, many paintings he did of his children. And he discovered when he was getting his training in Paris that he was really good at doing nude figures. They lived in this tiny town in Switzerland, and there were no models. So he used his wife and his children as models. His wife was only willing to pose once in the nude. All the rest of the time, she's fully clothed. But he loved painting flesh, and he did the children in the nude all the time, which didn't seem like a big deal at that time, but it had consequences, psychologically speaking. It's going to be hard to see. Okay, on the right, you see a poster of a painting that for an exhibit that Giovanni had in 1920, and there you see Alberto and Diego, who are now in their late teens, plastered all over Switzerland. And plastered all over Switzerland in a way that is not very, a little bit, let's say, embarrassing. And the father had the children pose for long stretches. They were just simply expected to do that because he was a good painter and they loved him and he was helpful, but hours would go on. So Alberto got into this from having the experience of being gazed at by the father for all these hours as a child. And there are many, many portraits of Alberto in every stage of his life that the father did. The whole series of the nude portraits, and I thought, that's strange. Never seen those before. They aren't exhibited usually, and nobody says anything about them. So that was one of the puzzles that, for me, evolved out of the trip to Zurich, which got me interested. And as I was then trying to make sense of this, I thought, okay, I can do this as an article. And I wrote it as an article, but it was too complicated. So then I had to do a second article. That didn't fit quite with the first one. So took 15 years, and then it became a book. Alberto and his family are so complicated that it took a long time to sort out first all of these myths about the happy childhood and so on. Now, I don't know how much you can see of the painting on the left. It's called The Sculptor. It's Giovanni is painting his wife, who has gray hair, and Alberto, who's making a sculpted portrait of her. And the green plastiline is the portrait that Alberto makes. Can you see that at all? The astonishing thing for me as a psychoanalyst and an art historian is that the generosity of the father, that he makes the portrait that his son has made the most vital part of this painting. It's the most alive part. His own portrait of his wife is, it's okay. I mean, it's better than okay, but the one that he shows off is the son's work, and that struck me as something, a part of the characteristic generosity of the father, which, as I did the research and talked to cousins and talked to other people, he was known as a very loving, very generous person, while his wife was dura. Okay. So now we switch to Alberto in Paris, and you see on the left, please notice Alberto's curly hair. Diego always had smooth hair, and Annette, I mean, you'll see why this matters. And there is Alberto in his very messy studio, for which he was famous. His mother was persnickety neat to beyond the beyond, and so he was someone who got involved in opposites all the time. So if you said black, he would say, no, that's white. And they would argue in ways. And so I'm sure that was part of the Anaihara story, that they would have discussions that went on and on. So here are two portraits done close to the same time. And the one of Annette, there were two people who posed for Alberto willingly all the time. One was Annette, and the other was Diego. Now, Annette has the same name as Alberto's mother, Annetta, and in sort of sour moments he would say, well, that's why I married you, which is not true. She was very pretty, and she was compliant and hardworking and helpful to him in many ways. And it's very clear that he was very much in love with her, although he was terrified of being married. He thought that would just finish him off. He had sexual problems, which he would proudly announce. So when Picasso was sitting there and talking about, well, this conquest and that conquest, Alberto would sit there and say, well, look, I'm impotent, so it's not a big deal for me. But nevertheless, with Annette, he didn't seem to have those problems, at least in the early years of their relationship. They got married in 49, and the early years of their relationship, they were very close, and with Diego, who finally accepted Annette, which he didn't initially because it was coming into this tight family, they were a triumvirate. So that photograph of the three, mm-hmm. It was very much the way they were, and the letters that he wrote home were about how much the three of us are enjoying life together. Okay, so the portrait of Annette is sort of characteristic, a portrait of by Giacometti. The one of Yanaihara, which was done, it was in the first year that he was there. What I want you to think about is this sense of this man is disappearing into the background and then reappearing. There's a coming and a going, and I think that was a piece for Alberto about Yanaihara that was crucial. This sense of you're here and then you're gone, and I want you to stay and then you're going to go. Now, keep in mind the father, as a painter and a successful painter in Switzerland, traveled a lot. And so when Alberto was growing up, the father would go to Bern or Paris or somewhere to have an exhibit or to judge a show. And Alberto is famous for having turned to his brother Diego and said, I can't remember what my father looks like. Please tell me, because he would out of sight be out of his mind. There was something about Alberto and the gaze and the connection with the father that was really important that got reignited in the relationship with Yanaihara. I think it's in the book, and Alvin and I have talked about it, that the relationship between Yanaihara and Alberto was of soulmates. They both were sons of famous fathers, successful famous fathers. They were actually more famous than their fathers, as it turned out. And they could talk about everything and anything. And Alberto was not known to be spiritual, but he was, in fact, very involved in a kind of spirituality and had great respect for Asia and Asian culture and was curious about it. Obsession, I'm not sure. I think fascination and connectedness and a sense of the closeness that Alberto could have with a man was very different than the ones he could have with women. And they, because of the closeness to the father, and when he was very little, he would go into the father's studio, and that's where he would play and draw and paint and grow up. And the other children were out running around doing other things. So there's a closeness to the father that goes back to the earliest childhood, that he would be able to sit and talk and paint someone over and over whom he felt equal respect for and love for, I think, was a large part of the connectedness. And this is my last slide. This is supposedly a portrait of Diego. And remember I told you Diego didn't have that curly hair? Alberto had it. And I was seeing a show in Paris with one of Alberto's cousins, and she said, that's not Diego. That's Alberto. That's a self-portrait. So all of the portraits with this fuzzy hair are really, in a way, about himself as well as the other. And I show you these two, sorry, not great slides, but good enough for you to see that if you look at the one that is facing you directly, the head disappears. The face is gone, right? So it's no longer there. If you look at it in profile, he's clearly present. So the whole issue of being present and being absent is central for Giacometti, and that's what I think is a key in Alvin's play. So that's my story.
Great, great. Absolutely. Thank you. And that relationship too. It was just talking about the famous fathers. Everyone knows a lot about Giacometti, but Yanahara, his it's very interesting how he chose to study existential philosophy. Like his father led a camp. His father was actually very well known early. He was Tadeo Yanahara, and he led a campaign pretty much to promote Jesus over emperor. And at that point in the early 20th century, it was like the emperor god. So it was really, so as you can imagine, he was quite a controversial figure in Japan at that time. And I probably still would be at any time. And it led to him losing some prestigious teaching positions. And it really, it's interesting to see how in Next Generation, it just made his son go to Paris rather than go from the battle of Jesus versus Emperor. He just said, no, I'm going to go one step further, and there's no God. I am just going to be there. And so in that solitude, I thought it was perfect, where Paris was the place where so many of the great 20th century art movements and great thinkers really somehow emanated from Paris. It was like a place where you could either go to reinvent yourself or just to really discover your true essence. And I feel he was doing that here. And the other element of this was, too, where that's in the story that Alberto and Annette had a very open relationship, so to speak. And it even led to the point where, if not the fascination or obsession, really just led to the point where Alberto insisted that they have an affair, Annette and Isaka Yanahara. And some of that we dramatize that in the play, though, too. And that really took them to a very different place, because he had a lot of trouble with intimacy, but he loved being like an observer, too. Some people said that maybe he was like a precursor to the Warholian observer, like taking a step back. So we look at these elements too. So it's interesting too, where he could do such sensuous work and be so intimate in his work as an artist, but yet as a person, he had a disconnect with that. So we try to look at that as well, and that's where the title of Three Trees comes from too. In addition, on one level, one etching that he was very enamored of was Rembrandt's landscape with three trees, and he refers to it a lot. And then in my play Three Trees, we talk about how there was this constantly shifting, like, triumvirate foundation, if you will. Of course, the very first one was with his family, and then in Paris it became Annette and Diego and himself. And then suddenly there's Isaku and having this very strong pull on them too. So they even talk about too, like one of the monologues towards the I guess we could read the ending out of context, but that wouldn't be too much of a spoiler alert. Or leave it at, then we could take some questions too, where you see, yes we've been doing revisions in the rehearsal process, so we see.
It gets better with each revision.
Well, thank you. Just there were two things I think towards the end. Just two statements. spoiler alert! I'm reading. I know I'm spoiling it. I'm reading the ending, but just two things. I won't tell you what's going on. But Isaku says, "In European painting, the person is the primary focus. The person will usually be the largest object in the tableau, but in most Asian painting, the landscape dominates the tableau, and the people are but small, complementary figures to that landscape. It's as if the artist is already seeing a bigger world beyond his own mortal life. The last time I walked the Louvre with Alberto, we meditated on Rembrandt's Three Trees. Alberto, between this world and the next, you will pass three trees. When I die, I imagine I will see a landscape just like this one. But just who or what those three trees are changes every day, every night. Every time my hands touch the clay or my brush touches the canvas, I will try to make those three trees my own. Every time I look at three trees, I'm reminded that there is more than enough to do before I die." It's just one little statement about some of the things that they talked about, and just in bringing all these things together. And last year we had the thrill of in Paris last year, I got to read some of the monologues by Isaku in the institution where he was studying when he met Alberto, and just all these timeless reverberations we try to capture in the play. So that's where you know, and that's being happening at the Pan Asian Rep, and I hope everyone gets to that. And I just want to open up for questions now, too, please. Any questions about the play, for Laurie, for anything in general, too? I just want to see, yes, please.
Was there a homoerotic subcurrent between Alberto and Yanahara?
Very much so. If you want to start with that, too, that would be...
Yes. James Lord really wanted Giacometti to be gay because he was, and he did everything he could to try to find out if he was, and Giacometti knew that and did everything he could to frustrate Lord. And I don't think there was any active homoerotic or homosexual activity, but Giacometti's closest friends were men, and that was from early on to the end of his life, and that's not an accident. So yes, there was a homoerotic thread.
Right. That's why, in many ways, too, I feel like there. In some ways, too, the consummation of that energy was actually in the creation of art when they were actually doing their work. That was, anyway, that was my how I interpreted that. That looking at that.
Well, also, yes. Annette was the vehicle between them, right? Which was common in the Surrealist period, and Giacometti went through. Grew up with the Surrealists, was the Surrealist sculptor, and Surrealist artists were constantly moving the women around and having their homoerotic relationship through that particular woman here or there. So I think that's a piece of what was going on with Yanahara.
Absolutely,
Annette.
Yeah. Annette, yes. So there was all that, absolutely. So there was that, yes.
I'd like to say that fascinating the way you talked about the narrative as portrait and the synergy of the soul exchange in art. And the director, Anne Bogart, in a class said, "I fall deeply and erotically in love with every actor in my cast, men and women." And of course I can't act on it. But she said, and it ends when the play ends. But I thought that was interesting. I was curious, how do you, with this huge life and everything in her book, how do you choose for the play?
Oh, well, you any life would fill up 100 plays, let alone that. So you really have to really, you know, focus in on one. I guess most storytelling is all about revolves around a turning point, a major turning point in a life. I guess we're almost there. I always tell my students, I always say, what's the Passover question? And I know that because growing up in the eighth grade, I was every weekend I was dancing the whore at a bar mitzvah, a bat mitzvah. So I know of what I speak in that sense, too. So in that way, too, when you sit down and tell a story, you always ask yourself, why is this night different than all others? So we look at the Passover question. And in many ways, this was Alberto Giacometti's life here was so rich, but this is one of the major turning points for him, and it just was a window into this life, and just it just reverberated with so many things. Like I was just getting really really obsessed almost with looking at the relationship of portraits and observer and artist and model, and this just really captured that too. And just looking at just the nature of it too, like another subtext is there they were in Paris and in the 50s, right after the war, and the Giacomettis are from Switzerland, Yanahara is from Japan, and what they were doing together in some ways could also be interpreted as they were creating like a new international order in some ways in the art world. And then being a New Yorker at that time too, the art world and the cultural world was in great transition. Parisians might not agree, but as the center was moving from Paris to New York, so there's all these things happening too. So this is a vehicle to explore a lot of that. And yes, I think you've got to just like in life, you got to choose your battles. In writing a play, you really got to choose that too, because you never I always think we all go to the theater, we go to any work of art, any book, just to really go deeper rather than try to have a very surface survey. So you really
and
find
my
that.
My follow-up question is, did you see the play and think, oh, he left this out, he left this out?
No, I felt that he had really gone into enormous depth. I was in tears after that reading. I thought, how did this man, has not done that kind of research, capture it so beautifully, capture the relationships and the characters. So I don't know if that answers your question, but he's a good playwright.
You can see the work of the Giacometti brothers in this country, but I've never seen anything by his father. Is it visible here?
Not so much. The father was not as good as his son in far as making a career, partly because the father was very connected to the mother and the mother didn't like travel. So while his best friend, who was Alberto's godfather, would go to Paris and spend time there and have exhibits there, Giovanni stuck to this small town and he would take these small excursions. So he didn't become famous. So his work is not so known internationally. And it's if you now with the internet you can find it, and he's an incredibly good sculptor, a good colorist, painter, and you can see that and see what he brought to Alberto in terms of teaching. There's one little story that's not quite answering your question. Alberto was working on a landscape across the street from the house, and his cousin came out and said, oh, this is wonderful. You're using all these beautiful colors like your father. The next day, of course, most of those colors were gone. It was gray and blue and white and black. And he had the little tiny traces of the color you can still see. So it was something to do with his oppositional nature. Since Giovanni was modest in his way and didn't push for an international reputation, Alberto was quite different. His best friends were all writers, André Breton, Sartre, mm-hmm. people who wrote about his work and helped make him famous. So the first catalog of his first show in New York was written by Jean-Paul Sartre. And Jean-Paul Sartre at that time was the most famous intellectual internationally. So Alberto knew how to make a career for himself. The father was a wonderful painter, a wonderful father, not so good as a careerist. So that's partly why they're hard to find in this country.
And the controversy, too, like just as how you said black, white, and just the next day the colors are gone. I think he famously said he had one of his black and gray works, and they said, well, isn't gray a color? And so there are colors here. Isn't gray a color? So he famously said that. Yes.
Well, I had two questions, one for Laurie and one for Alvin. First, Laurie, I was wondering if Giacometti left a sort of self-disclosing kind of diaries or journals, about his family or, those kinds of things. Did he keep,
He didn't keep diaries, but he wrote a lot of letters, and he was pretty eloquent in those letters. I mean, there are things that are diary-like in his adolescence, but he wrote a lot, not just of letters. He wrote essays sometimes about his work for catalogs. So one can go through his life and read what he had to say about what was going on in his life. It's very helpful for a biographer. Louise Nevelson wrote nothing. So, but she was interviewed by everyone. And anyway, that's another thing. I want to add something because Alvin, you said something about the drama. Alberto was a very dramatic storyteller. So he would sit around at these cafes in Paris and use the voice of a mountain man because he was from the mountains and tell stories that were totally entrancing. So he had a sense of drama, which I think you were able to capture. Okay.
Real, thank you, man. No, and he was always that way, too. And then later on, he became a very good friend of Samuel Beckett, too.
Right.
And somehow, maybe if there's more trees, as iconic as the iconic play Waiting for Godot is, the first Paris production, those are Giacometti pieces. So, yeah. I know some people associate that image with Godot as much as anything. So that he always had a flair for that, too. And,
yeah.
And always holding court and telling stories. That's why he would always go in those studios. Yes.
My question for you, Alvin, it's one of those dumb student questions. It's being a bio-asket anyway. Does being an Asian American writer or playwright add the track, give you any kind of, does it bring anything to this, or is it totally irrelevant?
Oh, to this being three trees, three trees first in general. Yes, well, with this, I thought it was very interesting, too. Like, as we know, everyone, like a lot of things that were created in that very, amazing, heady time, like even just you could say the whole Asian American movement is a direct result of the civil rights movement here in America. And it was a very liberating movement and term and really cause celeb for all of us at that time. And then people grew up in that, like Russell has been, a literary warrior in those circles for many years. And so, but now, as the world has been changing, how do we maintain this unity and yet still grow and reflect all the other interests in other ways too? So in some ways, that's why I'm very proud that this is being done with Pan Asian Rep too, because the Pan Asian Repertory Theater, they are true pioneers. They are the first Asian American theater company in New York City, I believe on the East Coast, too, definitely in New York City, And just to redefine what it means to be an Asian artist, an Asian American artist too, and I think it was more of a subconscious choice though too, where I think in many ways, no matter where we came out of the civil rights movement to now, like I think all of us were, and no matter where you are, I think everyone perceives of themselves on one level as the other outside of the mainstream, and in some ways too, I think that perception, that perspective, it was a natural with Yanahara in Paris. So it was really looking at a way to look at the world, but still maybe in another way too. Some people say that songwriters, playwrights, everyone's addressing the same three themes their whole career, so maybe as the great Leonard Cohen says, this is a new skin for the old ceremony in some ways. But I think it was another way to look at that on a more global plane and just look at that as well. But I think it's been in some ways too, like it's really helped us to have this great support network too, and just the camaraderie to grow as an artist and a person. But then like any families and all groups, sometimes you think sometimes the line between unity and codependency, they really blur sometimes, don't they? So you're always worrying about these things. It's been very powerful, and just like the communities here, like I'm really honored. This is my third talk with Ari, and I do them every 5 years. So I guess we'll be back in 2018, right? That's a wonderful question.
The other thing that people often forget about Asian American, artists and writers like yourself is that, probably grew up in the 60s and so forth. That 60s is closer to the 50s. So, besides the other aspect is not only civil rights, but what happened after the Bandung Conference and the decolonization. Mm-hmm. So, at that time, we were also, reading all that stuff.
Right.
From the newly decolonized countries, Africa, Asia, and so forth. So, I think there were actually, international models of new types of literature and expression and political systems that were kind of emerging at that time, too.
Absolutely.
And 60s.
No, in some ways, too, and I think that's what, just by, who and what he was, I think Yanahara was bringing this conversation to a different form, to maybe one of the most amazing forms ever, Paris in the mid-20th century was had. So I think looking at absolutely Russell, from that perspective, there was a lot of layers of that going on here, too. This is maybe that type of story in a new context.
How much of the dialogue is from the original, quotation of Giacometti and Yanahara, or is it all
dialogue?
Or? It's inspired by that. It's funny. None of you speak French at all, or read French.
I can read French. Mm-hmm.
So that helped your research a lot. You could go with firsthand a lot of sources too. Where my French is awful. I speak very, very little French. So it's in many ways it's all a transposition because in reality they were speaking French and so it's inspired by a lot of the stories I read and researched but the actual dialogue itself because it is in English is all imagined and fictionalized that way though too. Yes.
Did Giacometti ever think of, or even go to Japan?
No, I don't. No, I don't.
Did he ever?
He didn't much like to travel. He would stay where he traveled a lot between his home in Paris and his mother's home in Switzerland, and there he would go back and forth all the time. And he didn't really travel until she died. And then suddenly he was coming to New York and he was going to Sweden and he was going places that he hadn't been before. So in terms of going to Japan, that was way too far away. He also didn't like to use elevators and he had a few phobias that we haven't mentioned.
Was there a big age difference between the two?
Yes, he was about almost 20 years older than him.
Well, I'm not good with numbers. Right. Giacometti was in his mid-50s when they met.
Right, and he was in his later 30s. So there was quite a difference. But Isaac was much closer in age to Annette, too. That was something that happened there, though, too. You know, and I guess unlike Anne Bogart, they didn't exercise that sort of. Yes.
But take her at her word.
Oh, yes. It's funny how all these things come full circle. Last weekend, we were rehearsing in Anne Bogart's studio. So look at that. She had the biggest space over there on 8th Avenue. So, but I think Giacometti only came to New York once.
Right.
And that was for the year before he passed.
Exactly. He came because there was a big exhibit at the Museum of Modern Art. He also wanted to look at the Chase Manhattan Plaza because he was doing three sculptures for that. And he kept redoing them. And supposedly when he got back from New York, he was inspired and ready to go forward. But then he died. And why did he die at that time? Because his grandfather had died at age 65. His father had died at age 65. He was convinced he had to die at age 65, and so he did. His brothers, one lived to be 84, and the whiny crybaby lived to be 104.
So. Isn't that always the case? Wow. But I thought it's fascinating. We in the play we dramatized the whole Chase Manhattan Plaza as a metaphor for the New York pounding on the door though too. And I'm sure you've read them many times. He was here for his second exhibit at MoMA. Right, the first one was that Sartre wrote the great essay called "The Search for the Absolute" became that catalog. But even if it's not true, it's such a romantic image of after all the great dinners, after all the opening nights. Supposedly, Alberto and Annette went down to Chase Manhattan Plaza, and they were just walking around at that time. I just love to be able to walk where he walked, and we go down there and imagine, wow, this is where they were. Yes.
Do you know anything about Isaku and the bombing of Japan? Because that first painting of him, that kind of shadow above his head, and the way you said he's showing up and disappearing, do you know how he survived? Or?
No, I don't know, but I know, of course, like everyone at that time, he lost a lot of people in that too, everyone reacts differently, of course, but I think with him it made him a little more like a. Maybe even more of an implosion. He went deeper inside. He went deeper in to look, and that ultimately led him to, and also that's of course with all these things going on, how he came to be in Paris not long after the war is an amazing story too. It's hard to trace, and just something about him though too. And another thing they might have had in common where he was Janahar was married, had two daughters, and in all the journals that he was so nice to let me read, and everything else we've read. There's not one mention of him talking about his wife and two daughters. So in that way, very... he was made for Paris in the 50s, wasn't he?
Well, he came to study existentialism, and he wanted to meet Sartre, and that was the place to go. Right. So that it made sense. And when he would tell Giacometti that he couldn't come back or he couldn't stay longer, it was usually because of his university position. It was never about his family.
Right. He wasn't a family guy. So, and it's interesting too. Like the things, and then even just your discipline, your art was it wasn't just your discipline. It was a real like life and death camp. It really was like these were your divisions. And I think he eventually met Sartre, but I think one of the things he rued with Jan Hahn was that just as he arrived, Camus had the famous falling out with Sartre. So he was on the other side, and I thought, oh my God, am I ever going to meet Jean-Paul Sartre? And then that. I came about there, but how he got there was, and especially because his father was such a controversial figure, to let him go to the son, then go to Paris was very, had to be some high strings being pulled for that. Please, other questions for Laurie or myself? Yes?
When you showed the first photograph of the family, you pointed out the significance between the gaze of the mother and the son bisecting the photograph. Can you talk about why you thought that was significant?
It's not so much that I thought it was. Everybody sees that photograph and talks about, you see, Alberto is obsessed with his mother. And I, is this going to work?
Okay.
I used to show my students this photograph and say, so what's really the expression on Alberto's face? Because the conventional wisdom is he adored his mother, and that's why they're looking at each other with such intensity. But if you really look at that expression, that's not adoration.
No? He's looking for approval. He's checking her to see if he's
okay. I think he's also frightened, yeah. and there was something in that relationship that was powerful and dangerous, very different from the one with the father. I didn't put it in here, but there's another photograph taken, must have been 2 minutes later, where Annette is looking forward and Alberto's looking forward, and you don't see this. This became the quintessential story of Alberto's attachment to his mother. And I, as an analyst, I was suspicious of the conventional one way to see it. So I don't know if that answers your question.
Mm-hmm. Sort of. It's just the rest of the talk, you got into the relationship with him and his father. But how his relationship with his mother affected his art, I wasn't... It's a short talk, I know.
Well, he was certainly very connected to her and went to see her all the time and had to write to her. The children all had to write a letter every 3 or 4 days, depending on, because she wanted to get these letters back. And as soon as the phone lines came through, he had to call her every day. But it was a different kind of connectedness, in as I see it. Again, you see in all the portraits he does, the people are stuck there. And James Lord wrote a book about being the subject of a Giacometti portrait, and he says he supposedly recalls all the conversations, and so that's a dialogue that one can see. But Alberto did not like people to stop being the subject when he wasn't ready for them to stop. And so that kind of stuckness is partly from, I think, what was going on with the mother and Alberto, and partly from the experience of being the father's subject of the gaze all that time. And if you all know about Lacan or something about all of what he says about the gaze, Alberto knew Lacan. I mean, all these people were together in the Surrealist period, and he knew him for a long time. So I would guess that Alberto's staring at people had something to do with Lacan's understanding of the gaze, the famous gaze. And Alberto was famous for being shy about women, and he would go to a cafe and he would stare at a woman, and that's the way he would connect with her. I mean, until he finally got himself organized sexually. But there were times when, as an adolescent, he would go to a dance and there would be a girl he wanted to dance with, and he didn't feel like he could do that, so he would just sit there and stare at her. And this is already a long history of staring at someone and capturing them with a gaze. And there are some surrealist images that he made where you see the point is going to the eye, and it's the penetration with your eye of another person's being and essence, which is part of what happened with Jan Ihara, but also there was the loving connectedness. So people are complicated, but it's a good question. Everyone said it's all the mother and Alberto, and what I did was say, no, I think there's something else here too.
The fact that his wife was Annette, his mother was Annetta, it runs so deep. And it comes back to the quote before, where he said the only difference between the living and the dead is the eternal gaze. It comes into all these things, from that onto these influences. And also in terms of also getting out of their famous father's shadows, another person who was in with them, his New York representative was Pierre Matisse.
Right,
who was
with the famous father.
Son of Henri. So there was all these interesting, how that was another triumvirate, too, of these men from their famous fathers.
I want to say something about the eternal gaze. Giacometti was fascinated and really an adherent, in a way, of ancient Egyptian culture. And when he was in high school, he wrote an essay, which culture is better, the ancient Egyptians or ours? And he came out for the ancient Egyptians. But he knew that the definition for sculpture or sculptor in ancient Egypt was to keep alive. So the eternal part of the gaze is part of Giacometti's belief, secret belief, I think, that he could bring and keep something, someone alive by making sculpture.
You have one question about Giacometti. When he sculpted, his mothers, was he drawn to their characters or their features,
It's a good question. Probably both. I mean, there are lots of portraits he did of Diego. There are a fair number he did of Ottilia. There are not so many he did of Bruno. I think Bruno's the one who died at 104, the whiny. I don't think he liked Bruno so much. So that's part of why I think he didn't do as many portraits of him. So the character meant a lot, and the people he found fascinating were highly various, because Jean Genet he liked because he was bald, and that was really important because that meant he was like the Egyptian priests, who were also bald. So some of it is the facial features, and some of it is the character.
Along with that, I'm just curious about what became of the other children. I mean, did they take anything of their father, like Alberto did?
Well, Diego was a fabulous craftsman and did eventually a lot of furniture, famous furniture, and what are they called, chandeliers, so that the Picasso Museum in Paris is all his chandeliers and furniture around. So he continued as an artistic presence. Bruno, the youngest son, became an architect, and he was a reasonably okay architect, but being an artist was within the family. Ottilia was a weaver and did that quite a bit. And you need to know that Ottilia, as the daughter of Dura, the mother, was married to a doctor and living in Geneva, and got pregnant, and when it was time to give birth, the doctor said, you're going to need some help with this because it's complicated. And she said, no, I'm not going to accept any help. And she died in childbirth on Alberto's birthday, which was problematic. So she was being tough like the mother, and to die in Geneva when you're, in childbirth, that's really a stretch to be able to. It means that you've worked against yourself and your own health. So it's a complicated story.